fastenings. Okay, so we have seen what are the elements of a permanent way. Okay, that is rails, sleepers, ballast and rail fixtures and fastening. Now let us see again, we will repeat some of the things what we have studied in the cross section or of a permanent way, right? I think this is visible to you all, right? So the topmost portion, the bottommost portion is nothing but on a ground level, right? After the ground level, right, we will be having the subsoil. We are going to have the subsoil with the muram. Okay, this is we call it as a subsoil. Okay, so this soil is going to provide the stability to the ballast. Okay, so this is what we are we call it as an the we call it the subgrade. This soil we call it as a subgrade. It is we are going to have the stabilized soil over here that we have seen in the previous class. Then over this subgrade we will be having the ballast, right? It is going to provide the stability to the sleepers and over the to the rails. See, the rails will be taking directly the axial load, whatever the loads are coming from the railway wheels, it is first transmitted to these rails. Okay, the distance between the inside distance between the two rails we call it as a gauge. So the first element which is going to take the axial load, direct the axle load, whatever the load that the on a railway train is going to have, the first load is going to come to these rails, and these rails are going to shift the loads to the sleepers, right? On the bottom portion, wherever the rails are resting, this particular portion we call it as an sleepers. We call it as an sleepers. Then the sleeper is going to rest on these ballast, right? It is going to rest on these ballast. So it is going to transmit from the rails. The load is coming on the sleeper. Then the sleeper is going to shift the load to the ballast, and from the ballast, the load is going to be get transmitted to the subgrade, right? From the ballast, the load is going to be transmitted to the subgrade, and from the subgrade, it is going to be transmitted to the ground. Okay, so this is how the permanent way is going to be made. This is having the railways. Railway rails will be taking directly the load of the axle of the train, right? It is going to be transmitted to the rails. So rails are the first element which is going to take down the loads of the rail, your train, and then from the rails, it is going to transmit it to the sleepers. From the sleepers, it is going to transmit it to the ballast, and from the ballast, it is going to be transmitted to the subgrade. So I hope the permanent way it is clear to you all. Now, in the previous class, we have discussed what are the different elements of a permanent way, right? That is, it is going to have subgrade, it is going to have ballast, sleepers, rails, and then fixtures and fastening. Fixtures and fastening we have discussed in the previous class. Now we have also discussed in the previous class regarding the requirements of an ideal permanent way. We have also discussed all these things in the previous class, and then in today's class we are going to discuss on the regarding the rails. Okay, in today's class we are going to discuss on a rails. I am audible to you all? Yes, can anybody
Yes,
hear? Okay, it is clear. Yes,
yes,
sir.
sir.
Okay, then we will today in today's class we are going to discuss on the rails. Now first we will see, before going to have these types of rail and all, we will see what should be the properties of a rails and what are its function. Now as I have told you, the rails are the continuous girders. It is nothing but it is a girder which is going to take the axial loads, right? Axial loads of the train, and it is a continuous girder. As you have seen that the rails are the it is a continuous girder which is going to take an direct load of the train. It is going to take the direct load of the train. Okay, I will show how the rails will be, okay, how the rails will be, okay, just a minute, it is going to come on your screen. Okay, so double head, I will see your double headed rail. It is, we are going to have the different types, right, in the rails. Okay, first we will see what are the different elements, that what are the functional requirements or how it is going to function. Okay, they provide, first thing, okay, the rails are going to provide a smooth uniform surface, right? It is going to provide the smooth and the uniform surface. The rails are going to provide the smooth and the uniform surface, right? Smooth and uniform surface to bear the wagon loads. That is, wagon is nothing but the train loads transmitted through the axle. It is going to take the entire, see, this is nothing but your rail is. This is nothing but your rail is. We call it as a double headed rail, right? In this particular portion, right? In this particular portion, the top particular portion, we call it as an head, right? The top portion, we call it as an head. The middle portion, we call it as an web. And the bottom portion, we call it as a base. Okay, we call it as a base. So head, web, and this is a base. Okay, so it is going to provide the smooth surface. See, the loads, the wheel is going to, the train wheel is going to come over this particular upper head. We call this as a head. So this is going to take the entire load over here, then it is going to transmit to the web, and then it is going to be transmitted to the base. Okay, now in addition to the vertical load, right, what it does is, it is going to take the lateral stresses also. Here it is going to take the lateral stresses also due to the braking and due to the temperature. See, since this is made up of a metal, right, what will happen, the, again, as there is a variation in the temperature, it is also going to take the stresses developed due to the variation in temperature. Not only the vertical load it is going to take, it is also going to take the lateral load also, and it is also going to take the temperature variations also. Okay, now because of the quality control exercised during the manufacture of the rails and the rolling stock, the wear and the replacement cost is comparatively very, very little, and failure due to wear is rare. Okay, now we are going to maintain a very high quality control when we are going to manufacture these rails, because these rails are going to take the direct load, whatever is going to come on, whatever the load that the train is having, this is the first element which is going to take the load on it. So whenever we are going to take the loads of these particular rails, we need to manufacture it with the high precision, and the high quality control has to be maintained when we are going to manufacture these particular rails. So quality control we are going to maintain to the very higher side. Okay, and the wear and tear is, that is going to happen due to the continuous momentum of these wheels, right? The wear and tear that is going to happen is very slow, and it is the failure of our railway due to this wear and tear is very, very rare. I don't say that it is going to have the wear and tear. It is going to have the wear and tear, but it is very, very slow. Okay, so this is, we call it as an this is how we are going to maintain the quality control. Okay, the rails transmit the load due to the formation through the sleepers and the ballast. It is going to transmit the load to the formation. Now what is formation here? The formation is nothing but, right, this is your it is going to transmit the load from the rails to the formation level. Formation level is nothing but your subgrade. We call it as a subgrade. So that is your formation level, from the rails to the sleeper, from the sleepers to the ballast, and from the ballast to the formation level. Formation level, I repeat, it is nothing but your subgrade, which is consisting of the soil. Okay, so this is what this is how your rails is going to be maintained. Then we will see what are the different properties these rails is going to have. Okay, the properties of rails are, it should have the adequate height, right? This is, it should have the adequate height. They see, when it comes to the height part, right? When it comes to the height part, this is nothing but from the head to the base, right? From the head to the base, whatever the height it is going to come, it is nothing but we call it as an the height of the rail. It should have the adequate height so that the area provided to resist the vertical shear is going to be adequate. Okay, it should have the proper height. Then it should have the adequate surface, right? It is nothing but it is the surface, the horizontal width of the rail. It is, we call it as a surface, right? It should have the adequate surface of contact with the axle flanges, and it is going to have the sufficient area of contact with the sleepers. At the head also, it should have the sufficient contact with the axle of the wheel, and it should have the base also, it should have the sufficient contact with the sleeper. See, this bottom portion, it is going to be connected with the sleepers with the help of the hooks and all, right? It is going to be connected to the sleepers with the hooks and all. So it should have, the top portion also should have the sufficient area, and the bottom portion also should have the sufficient area, right? Then the third point that we are going to have in the rails is the bottom of the head and the top of the foot. We call this base as a foot also. This is a head portion, this is a web portion, and this is, we call it as a base portion also, or we call it as a foot portion. Head, web, and foot, or base portion. So we call it this as a base as well as we call it as a foot. The bottom of the head, that is the foot portion, and the top of the foot of the rail should be shaped so that it is going to have the fish plates, right? It should so that the fish plates transmit the vertical load from the head to the foot, right? With having the joint satisfactorily. See, in this web portion, wherever we are going to have, whenever we are going to join the two rails with the having the fixtures and fastener, this web portion is going to be connected with the the various kinds of the fixtures and fastener. At this particular thing, the web portion also should have the sufficient area in order to have the fixtures and fasteners to fit it properly. Okay, so this top portion should have the sufficient area, this also sufficient area of contact, and the web portion also should have the sufficient area of contact in order to connect with the your axial load of the wheel, as well as to the sleepers, as well as to have the your fixtures and fastener at the web portion. The center of gravity of the section should be approximately at the mid height so that the maximum tensile and the compressive stresses are going to be equal. Okay, the CG of the your rails should be designed, should be proper. Okay, the stress concentration should be avoided by having the heavy large radius of fillets. Okay, so that is also one of the requirement. The rail section should satisfy the falling weight at the specified by the as by the Indian Railways. Okay, so these are nothing but the different properties. So it should have the sufficient height, it should have the sufficient width, it should have the sufficient area of contact, right? It should have the sufficient of contact with the axial with the axle of the wheel. It is going to have the sufficient area of contact for the sleeper, sufficient area of contact for the your fixtures and fasteners, and it should have the it should have the adequate capacity to bear the loads that is going to be the compression or and the tensile load coming from the wheels, and it should have the sufficient capacity to bear the lateral and the temperature variation. So these are the different properties that the rails should have. It should take the sufficient compression load, tensile load, all these things it is going to have. Okay, so this is nothing but the ideal requirement of the rails. Now we will see what are the different types of the rails. What are the different types of the rails that we are going to see? Now, the first thing that we are going to have in the rails is, right, that is the double-headed rail. Okay, now this we call, this particular thing, we call it as a double-headed rail. Okay, now here, why we call it as a double headed rail is, right? Why we call it as a double headed rail is because of, right? Because of, see, this is also a head portion, and this is also the head portion and the base portion. They are both are having the same dimension. As you can see, the dimension of the head portion as well as the base portion or the foot portion are the same. The rail section whose foot and head are of the same dimension. See, here the head portion is also having the same dimension, and the base portion or the foot portion is also having the same dimension. So that is the reason why we call it as a double-headed rails. Okay. In the beginning, what used to happen is these rails were widely used in the railway track. These double-headed rails were widely used in the railway track. Okay. Why the idea behind using these particular rails was, right, when the head portion worn due to the rubbing action of the wheels, the rails can be inverted and it can be reused. Why we are going to use these particular double headed rail is, the reason is due to the wearing action, right, due to the wearing action of the the head, due to the rubbing of the wheel and the top head, what would have happened is, right, these head portion of the rails would have gone worn out, and it can be inverted, right? It can be inverted as a base, and the lower the base portion can be utilized as a base. So that is the reason why these particular section where we were using it in a larger extent. Okay, the reason why we were using the double-headed rail is due to the rubbing action of the wheels, the head section of the rails would have gone worn out, and then by replacing this top portion into the bottom portion, the lower portion will become the now top portion. So the bottom portion can be reused again instead of completely turning that particular rail into a waste, right? We can do this particular thing. So that is the reason why we were using the double headed rail to the greater extent. But what had happened is, it was found that the foot could not be used as a running surface because it is also got corrugated under the impact of the wheels. But what had happened is, it is found that the base portion, due to the corrugation, what had happened due to the corrugation and due to the impact of the wheel load, it is found that the base portion is also going to be worn out. So this type of rails is not going to be used nowadays. This type of a rail is not going to be used nowadays. So this is what your double-headed rail is. Okay. So this is what the double-headed rail is. So here we can see the top portion is also having the same dimension, and the bottom portion is also going to have the same dimension at the bottom. So this is what we call it as a double-headed rail. Now, the double-headed rails were having the length of around 9.2 to 18.3 meters in length. Okay. Now, this double-headed rail length. So this is the length, right? This is the length. These double-headed rails were having around the length of around 9.2 to 18.3 meters, and it is going to have the weight of around 30 kg to 50 kg per meter length, the weight it is going to have. The per meter, it is going to have the weight of around 30 kg to 50 kg per meter length. Okay. The rails are fixed to the sleepers by means of chairs. Okay. Now you can see the rails are going to fixed to the sleeper. This is the sleeper. It is going to be attached to the sleepers with the help of, see, this is nothing but the chair. Okay, this particular portion, it is going to be attached to the sleeper with the help of the chair. Okay, this is a different type of rail, but I am showing, in order to show the chair, I am going to show how the rails is going to be connected to the sleepers. Okay, so this is how how the rails is going to be connected to the sleeper. See, we are going to use the chairs, whereas the base portion is going to be get attached, or get, it is going to be rested on the chairs, right? And it is going to be connected with the nut and bolt, and it is going to be connected to the sleeper. So this particular portion, we call it as a sleeper. Okay, this is a sleeper portion, this is a chair portion, and this is your rail portion. Okay, so in detail, we will be studying the things later, but we will move to the other part of, say, then the head, it should be the it can be attached to this particular, the rails can be attached to the either the steel sleepers or either concrete sleeper or wooden sleeper with the help of the chair. Okay, now in order to attach the these particular rails, we require two sleepers, the cast iron, we require, right, two cast iron chairs per sleeper in order to attach these particular say your rails. We require two chairs, here one side chair, here one side chair. So one rail, in order to attach to the sleeper, we require two chairs, here one chair and this side one chair and this side one chair. So we require two chairs in order to attach it to the rail, you know, sleepers. Then we will see what are the bull-headed rails, right? These particular thing, we call it as a bull-headed rail. Okay, now why we call it as an, am I audible to you all? Are you people are there?
Yes, sir.
Are you understanding the concepts?
Yes, sir.
No problem?
No, sir.
Okay, the speed is okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. We'll move ahead. Now, the second thing, we call it as a bull-headed rail. So first type was the double-headed rail, and the second type was bull, second type is bull-headed rail. Now, why we call it as a bull-headed? Okay, now the rail section whose head dimension are more than that of the foot are called as a bull-headed. See, the head portion, you can see it is having the more depth. Here it is a 46 mm, it is 33 mm. So head portion over here, it is having the higher depth and it is of the higher dimension that the foot portion. See, the width is also larger and the depth is also larger, right? The width is also larger, the depth is also larger. See, the foot portion, the width is also smaller and the depth is also smaller as compared to the head part of the rails. So we call this particular thing as a bull-headed rails. Okay, due to, since the head section of the rail is having the larger dimension than the foot section, we call it as a bull-headed rail. Okay, this type of a rail, the head is made little thicker and stronger as part to the lower part, as lower part of the rail as concerned. And then these rails also require the chairs for holding them in position. Okay, so we will discuss regarding chairs and all later on, but we will concentrate our study on the rails now. Okay, these rails require the chairs in order to hold them in position with the sleepers. Okay, especially when near to the points and marking. Now we will see what are the merits of the bull-headed rails and what are the demerits of the bull-headed rails. Okay, the bull-headed rails keep a better alignment and it is going to keep, right, provide more smoother and the stronger track. It is going to provide, the bull-headed rails are going to provide better alignment, right, and more smoother and the stronger track. Okay, so that is one merit. And then these are going to provide the longer life to the wooden sleeper and greater stability to the track. Okay, and then they are easily removed from the sleepers, and hence the renewal of the track is going to be very easy as compared to the other type of the rail. So that is the reason why we used to have these bull-headed rails. Now, what are the demerits? Now, the bull-headed rails require an additional cost of iron chairs, right? It requires the more amount of iron chair, as they are saying in the points and crossing, they require more amount, more number of chairs. Okay, these chairs, these rails require heavy maintenance and the cost. They require heavy maintenance and the cost. The bull-headed rails are having the less strength and the less stiffness. So that is nothing but the regarding the bull-headed rails. Now, we will concentrate our study on the flat footed rails, right? We will concentrate our study on the flat footed rails. Okay, so I will show what are the different flat footed rail. We will see first regarding, we will study the things and then we will see how the flat footed rails are. What are the flat footed rails are? Okay, now the flat, these particular, as the name is suggesting, the flat footed rails, right? As the name is suggest, it is telling, the flat footed rails are nothing but, as compared to the head section, the base section or the base, right, or the base of the base or the foot of the rails is having the larger width, right, as compared to the head. So that is the reason why we call it as a flat footed rails. That is the reason why we call it as a flat footed rail. These rail section are having their foot rolled to flat are called as flat footed rails. As I have told, this is an the foot portion of the rail are flat. So that is the reason why we call it as a flat footed rail. It was initial thought that the flat footed rails could be fixed directly to the wooden sleeper and it is going to be eliminate the chairs and the keys required for the bull headed rails. It was thought that the flat footed rails can be directly imposed into the sleepers without the chairs. That is the reason why we have brought this. But it was found that due to the heavy rail, due to the heavy train loads, the foot of the rails, it is going to used to sink under the wooden sleepers and it is and making the spikes loose. Now what are these spikes and all, we are going to see later on. But what had happened, these flat footed rails, the spikes, in order to fix these of foot your foot of the rails into the sleeper, we are going to add the spikes. So due to the heavy loads of the wheel, what it is going to create, it is used to create a huge impact on the bottom portion of your foot, and then the spikes, it is you the spikes that is that has been added in order to tighten with the sleeper, it has started to loose. So that is the reason why the spikes were getting loosed. Okay, now to remove these particular effect, the steel bearing plates were used in between the flat footed rails and the wooden sleeper. Now due to this problem, what had happened is they used to apply the steel bearing plates in the flat footed rails and the wooden sleepers. Now these particular sleepers are most commonly used in India. Okay, these flat footed rails are most commonly used in the Indian railways. They are normal, the Indian railways is using the flat footed rails. Now what are the merits we are going to see regarding the flat footed rails? The flat footed rails, how it is going to have the more strength and the stiffness, right? It is going to have the more strength and the stiffness. No chairs are required in order to hold them in a position. Then these rails require less number of fastenings. What are fastenings? We are going to discuss later. Then the maintenance of the cost from the these flat footed rails is going to be less. Then the demerits, the fittings get loosened more frequently. The fittings are going to get loosened more frequently, and right, these rails are not easily removed, and hence the renewal of the track is going to become difficult, and it is difficult to manufacture the points and crossing of the rails. Okay, so this is what we have discussed in today's class regarding what are the different types of rails, right? What are the different types of rails? See here, whatever we have, we will see some of the flat footed rails, right? We will see some of the flat footed rails. We have seen this is what your flat footed rail is. See here, the head portion is there, and this is the web portion, and this is the this is your foot portion. So we call it as a flat footed rail. We call it as a, this is the head portion, this is the web portion, and this is the foot portion. So it is called as the flat footed type of rail. Flat, it is what? The flat footed type of rail. So this is what I was speaking. This is regard, this is what the chair is, right? This is what the chair is, and this is the hooks in order to hold the sleeper, hold the your rails on the on your sleepers. So this is how it is going to be maintained. See, you can see the difference between the double headed rail. This is your double headed rail, this is the bull headed rail, right? And then this is the flat footed rail, right? So this is how your rails is going to be get varied with the help of its size and shape. Now in the next class we will be studying regarding the sleepers, right? What are the different types of, we will see what are sleeper, what are the functions of sleeper, then what are the requirements of a sleeper, and then different types of the sleepers in the next class. Okay, I hope the things are clear to you all. Yes.
Yes, yes, sir.
Is the thing how the classes, the speed and the regarding the topic, is it okay with you? Is it okay?
Okay, sir.
Regarding speed, is it fine?
So fine, sir.
Okay. Anybody is having any kind of a problem? Veena Talwar, do you have any problem?
No, sir.
Sagar? Sagar lad?
No, sir.
Shakir?
No, sir. No problem. Everything is going
Shashidhar.
Fine.
Shashidhar?
No, sir. No, sir.
Sachin? Sachin?
No, no, sir.
Okay. Vishwanath? Vishwanath? Rasha?
No, sir.
Rasha? Yes, sir. No,
do you have
problem,
any problem,
sir.
Understanding,
no,
the concepts?
Yes, sir.
Rutu? Rutu Jalsangi?
No, sir.
What, you are understanding or no?
Understanding, sir.
The things, how the way it is presented, are you happy with it?
Ha, sir, okay.
Are you understanding the concepts?
Ha, sir, understanding.
Sanjana?
Yes, sir.
Do you have any problem? Voice is clear?
Yes, sir.
Is there any disturbance in between?
Sir, sometimes due to network. Otherwise, it's okay.
Okay. Anybody is having any kind of a problem with the voice and all? Is it clear? Please reply.
Yes, sir.
Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Voice, is there any disturbance?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Niket?
No, sir. No, sir.
Okay. Good. Fine then. I hope the things are clear to you, and if you have any kind of a doubt, you can ask me at any time. You can WhatsApp me or you can call me if you are having any kind of a doubt. So in the next class, we will be studying regarding the sleepers. Okay, what are the sleeper? What is its requirement? What are the different requirements of a standard sleeper? And then what are the different types of it that we are going to study in the next class? Okay, thank you. We will meet in the next class. Thank you.